Okay, it's 9:40, so let's get started. How many weeks left? 3? We're almost there. Alright, so quiz 11 is out tomorrow, so we definitely will have more than 10 quizzes, right? So 11 is out tomorrow. There's some pretty fun problems on there, you'll see them tomorrow. Homework 5 is out and also has some pretty cool problems on there. So it's like differences of powers of numbers or something. It's pretty interesting. So any questions before we start? Okay, so what did we talk about last week? Yeah, so variations of Turing machines, but what else did we also do? What kinds of languages did we talk about? One starts with a D, one starts with an R. Coincidentally, my initials. What?
Decidable.
Yeah, decidable. And what? Yeah, recognizable. So, let's start off with recognizable. What does it mean for a language to be recognizable? And don't confuse this with saying the Turing machine is decidable or recognizable, but languages. Okay? So, what does it mean for a language to be recognizable? A Turing machine recognizes a language. What does that mean? What is the only thing that we need to ensure about the strings in the language here? Something about halting and accepting, or something like that. What is it? Well, something about the strings in the language. What do they have to? They have to be accepted, right? There's no use having a Turing machine for some language and the strings in the language not being accepted. Okay, so let's say the language is L, then we'll say every W in L when run on the TM will halt and accept. So every string in the language of the machine, it better halt and accept, right? Well, that's all nice and good, but what about the strings, say, not in the language? There certainly could be strings not in the language. What do we say on those? For recognizable. Do I care? No. All I need is that the strings in the language halt and accept. And the other strings, you must make sure that they also don't halt and accept. You don't want to accept strings that are not in the language. But what else could they do other than halting and rejecting the strings not in the language? Yeah, they could run forever. Okay? So I'm not ensuring anything with the recognizer. But with a decider, what do I have to say? It has to hold on which string? Decide. All strings. Yep. So every W in sigma star, when run on TM, will halt. And I don't say accept here, because it doesn't necessarily accept everything. So we have to say that every W in L will accept, and every W not in L will. Right? So every single string in the language will accept, and every string not in the language will go to the rejected statement, or we'll just say rejected in this case. Okay. Any questions about those two definitions? Yeah.
So then, I guess the difference between the two the language that's working here, that would they be
streaming? Not necessarily, because it could be the case that every single string not in the language will reject, call them reject. It could be the case that every single string will loop infinitely, right? I'm not stipulating anything. And in fact, we will eventually see a language that is recognizable but is not decidable. Okay? Just give you a sneak peek, I guess. It's called ATM. So we will talk about this, but it's the set of all machines encoded as strings where and input strings and M accepts W. I'm not proving this, I'm just giving you a sneak peek. So this is saying that if you want to decide whether a given machine accepts a string, that is not decidable but is recognizable. Okay? Just as an example. But any other questions about this? Okay, well, let's do some of the questions. So this one says, I want every string that's in sigma star and put the exact same string, the concatenated copy with it, and I want to recognize or decide this language. Okay, and I said that we need to use two tapes. But a Turing machine only has one tape, and I'm saying you need to do two tapes. Is that different? Am I doing more here than a normal Turing machine could? No, why? If we have two tapes, how can we use one tape to simulate this two-tape guy?
Could you place a marker between the two tapes?
Yeah, so let's just say that the contents on this one are A1 through AN, with blanks obviously. And then B1 through BM, it could be totally different lengths. Then, as was suggested, we just put both of them on the tape with a separate. No problem. Okay, no issue there. So I could use two tapes, and I know because of this that I can use a one tape Turing machine to recognize this or decide it. So therefore, I haven't changed whether this is a decidable language or recognizable language because I can convert it to a single tape Turing machine. Okay, well, do you see any problem with this that might make this a little difficult? So what I need to do is, with whatever remaining tapes I have, I want to check if this the input that's given to me is the same string on both sides, okay? But what's the problem with that? What seems difficult? What's that? Yeah, I don't know where it starts, the second part, right? I have no idea. Is that an issue? It seems like an issue, but could I use two tapes to make this easier? Yeah, so what would, in a high-level idea, this is not a low-level description, but this is a high-level idea. What is a very quick initial check I can make sure that it's not of that form? Something about the length. What's that? Well, I'm given a single string. I don't know where the separator is yet. What's that? Yeah, if it's not even length, then I should reject immediately because it's not the same string on both sides. So first, check if input length is odd. If so, reject. Otherwise, I shouldn't accept because just because it has even length, then that doesn't imply anything. about whether it's the same string on both sides. But if I get to this next stage, I guarantee it's even. So that's good. Okay, well, let's see. So now I have a string that I guaranteed is even in length, but how can I check that it's the same string on both sides?
Yeah,
split it up. Okay, well, how am I gonna split it up? What's that?
Like along the midpoint.
Yeah, but I don't know where the midpoint is. What's that? Well, I can't, or where am I gonna store them? Oh, I guess that could work. Yeah, that's an idea. So here's an ideal one. This is not the one I was thinking of, but this is an idea. So how can I use the second take to help? Well, what I do is I store the length on the tape. Okay? Then what do I do to find the midpoint? 5 by 2. Okay? So store length on the second tape. Divide by 2. Well, once I do that, once I divide by 2, okay, now I know how far I need to go on the first tape to find the midpoint. But wait, what do I do after that then? There are actually two things you can do here in this case, but what is something I could easily do? Okay, yeah, that's an idea. So I guess I'm gonna have two sub ideas here. So if this isn't evident to you already, there are many ways to make Turing machines, just like there are many ways to write a program, right? There are many perspectives you can take here. So idea 1A, all right, idea 1A, insert special, I guess we're not gonna go to a low level description here because there are many high level ideas here. Insert special character at midpoint on first tape and implied by that is shift all contents to that are right of midpoint, right one position. That's what I mean by insert special character at the midpoint. That's implied that I push everything else to the right of it one position. And then now what do? Now I have this special character in the middle, what do I do? What must the string be on both sides of this special character? It must be the same, so do I know how to do that? Yeah, zigzag like we did last time. So check if the string on both sides is equal. If so, accept. Otherwise, reject. Okay. So let's look at that so far. Does that algorithm, in a sense, always halt? Well, let's see. Does this part always halt? Checking whether the input has even length. Yeah, that we can easily do that. Store the length on the second tape. Could I do that and halt? Does that only take a finite amount of time? Yeah, so what I do is, so this is a low-level idea. Every time you see a character, put a single character on the second tape. Then just march along. So it's only the length of the input, so that takes a finite amount of time. What about this one? Putting a character in the middle. Does that take a finite amount of time? Yeah, so if the input's finite, obviously. So, well, here's the... I guess there are two ideas. This is the only real idea. I thought I had two ideas. I guess I only have one. But we know how to move a character over because what we do is, once we write the special character in, there was some symbol there. So therefore, I remember what I just wrote, and then write it in the next position, and then at that point, I remember what I wrote, and then move to the next position, and then I keep going until the end. So that does take a finite amount of time, and this is implied by what that is. Check if the string on both sides is equal. Does that take a finite amount of time? Yeah, so what can I conclude about this language? It's decidable. Because I just made a Turing machine that always halts. Well, gave a high-level ideal for one, but we know how to do each of those parts. Okay? Is this language context-free? Turns out it's not. 0 to p, 1 to p, 0 to p, 1 to p will get you out. Okay? So, we just show that there is a language that's decidable, but not context-free. Pretty interesting. What's in the second idea that we could do? And this is a little bit more brute force, in a sense. And the good thing about this second idea is that I don't have to rely on my ability to do division. Okay? So, what would that idea be? And it's using the second tape to help me. Let's see. And so, let's just look at this as a picture, and then we can see what's going on. So here are my two tapes. And let's say we have 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. And that's blank, obviously. And this is currently blank. Okay. And by definition, I should accept that string, obviously. So, how can I use this to help me? The second tape to help me? Well, for this second idea, I don't have this length on the second tape anymore. So I don't know where the midpoint is. Well, let's try this. Move one character down, and then make this one. Oh, and then I can just leave that, I guess. Then what do? Actually, I should make this one. What should I do with those two strings? Not necessarily check if they're equal yet, because if they're the same string, then if they're not the same string, then it would be reasonable that I reject, but clearly, I shouldn't reject yet, or accept yet. So, what should I be checking against these two strings? Not the strings themselves, their lengths. If I check their lengths, then this guy has a longer length than this side, right? So therefore, I haven't moved enough characters over. So what do? I move another character over. And then cross everything out. Then I check, are these two strings' lengths the same? No, not yet. If they are, then let's just say we do one more iteration, because they're not the same length yet, so therefore I move one character more over, take it off at the top, and then now I'm currently pointed at the beginning of both of these. And I check, is the length the same? And it happens to be yes in this case. Should I do another iteration if the lengths are the same? No, because if I move another character over, this side will definitely have longer length than the first one. So I should stop when they have the same length, okay? Once they have the same length, now what do I check? If they are actually the same string. Because The only possibility that they really are the same string is when they have the same length. So the idea is, iteratively, move pairs from first tape to second tape. If at any point the strings on both tapes have the same length, then check, I should say, then stop looping, then check equality on both. If equal, then set, otherwise, okay. So these are two somewhat different ideas, but they accomplish the same thing. And the nice thing is that this second idea also shows that the language is decidable. So just because one Turing machine is for the language doesn't imply that there isn't another one with a completely different idea for the same language. Cool. Any questions about that? How would I do this with one tape? Well, you say, well, you can do it with two tapes. Just do that conversion that we did to make it one tape. Yeah, that would definitely work. But how would I do it directly using one tape? Without even thinking of two tapes. Now, finding that midpoint is going to be a problem, right? So what do you think I should do? I can check whether the string's length is odd and then reject, no problem. So I ensure that the string's length is even. Then what do? Just start marking characters. Mark every other character. And then at some point, you're going to reach the end, and then if you ever come back and then do this scanning process again, and you mark incorrectly, then the language is, it's not of the right form. So it's a little bit more complicated because I don't have this nice second tape to work with and putting everything I want in the second tape, but I invite you to think about how you would do this with just a single tape, nothing else. Okay? Any questions about this whole? Is this language recognizable? You said it was decided. Is it recognizable?
Yeah.
Yeah, why?
Because decidable is something recognizable.
Exactly. Every decidable language is recognizable. Because decidable languages already satisfy what I need to do for being recognizable. It's just recognizable. It doesn't care what happens to the strings not in the language. Nice. All right, so this is a little bit more interesting. Well, I think both are very interesting, but this is more mathematical. I want all the strings that are Fibonacci number length, right? Okay, so f of n is the nth Fibonacci number, and I want strings of that. Okay? This happens to not be context-free, but I'll let you figure out how to do that. It's pretty interesting about how to prove that. Okay, so how would I show that this is decidable? What's an easy way to show that it's decidable? How about I just make the Turing machine for it? That always helps. Okay. So, what's a high-level idea that we can do? So the tape is going to have a bunch of zeros on it. Well, then how am I going to check if that length is actually a Fibonacci number? Well, let's see. Let's say that the Fibonacci's length. So, who doesn't know what the Fibonacci numbers are? Just to me right now. If you remember, f of 1, so I'm going to start at 1 here, index of 1. So f of 1 is 1, f of 2 is also 1, and f of n is f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2. So from this we have f of 3 is 2, f of 4 is 3, f of 5 is 5, f of 6 is 8, it's 2, and that's 13, and f of 8 is 21, So this is a Fibonacci sequence. So let's say that the input is 0 to the, let's say, 14. So clearly, it's not a Fibonacci number, right? How do you know? Well, it's definitely not 13, and it's definitely not 21. How do you know it's not equal to another one? Does this sequence just keep going up and up and up and up and up? So after 21, can it ever equal 14? So what do I need to check? All the numbers, or the Fibonacci numbers, up to when we get larger in length than the input. So should I ever change the input? No, because I want to maintain this in checking the length. Do I have a way of checking whether two strings where one is shorter length than the other? Yeah, we have this way of zigzagging if we were using one tape, and then just check if we marked everything on the first half and there's something on the second half, then the second half has something as length longer. Okay, so here's the idea. I'm gonna use a graphical representation. So the input is gonna be stored here on one tape. Well, I should never change the input. I could do this on one tape, but I wanna make this easier for me. So, let's see. If I have the input here, how many other tapes do you think would be a good idea? Well, let's see. It might be a good idea to store at least two more tapes to store the previous computed values. Okay. Well, let's see. Where am I going to put that result? Well, I could put it on another tape, so that seems like a good idea. So, I'm going to put the result tape here. So this, in my mind, means f of n. This is f of n minus 1. This is f of n minus 2. Let's see. Suppose I have f of n minus 1 and f of n minus 2 here. Could I get f of n? Yeah, how would I do it in a low-level description? If I have a bunch of zeros on this tape and a bunch of zeros on this tape, how can I add them here? Concatenation, right? So that's one way of doing it. The way I should spell it right. Another way you can do it is have both tape heads at the beginning of both of these tapes, and then every time you see a zero on one of the two tapes, move this guy by 2. That's another way to do it. Because we're in unary, concatenation is the same as addition. So that's really nice. Well, once I start off, what should I put on these two tapes at the very beginning? Base case. What's the smallest Fibonacci number? 1. So I should, at the beginning, put a 1 on these two tapes. Okay? And then I compute the result here and check if the input's equal to this, then it is a Fibonacci number. Good. If the input's length is less than f of n, then I should stop and reject if I haven't accepted at that point. If the input's length is more than f of n, what should I do? Have I gone far enough? No. So I do it again. So here, let's write our ideas down. So, have four tapes. Oh, question. Is it okay if I use four tapes, or do I need to use one? Again, use the same idea, just concatenate the tapes as needed. So we can use four tapes here as equivalent. Fine. So, so just to remind ourselves, input on first, f of n on second, f of n minus 1 on third, f of n minus 2 on fourth. Okay. Well, let's see. So what's really nice about doing high-level descriptions is that I can appeal to all of the programming knowledge I have. So I'm going to write a while. Because you can definitely implement this on Turing. So while, what has to be true in order for me to keep going? Well, yeah, if the input's length is, in a sense, more than the f of n's length. So while input length is strictly more than f of n length. What should I do? Well, what I should do is add these two guys. I'll do this one. So if f of n's not large enough, what should I do? I should add these two guys and put them here. Okay. So add f of n minus 1 and f of n minus 2 onto f of n. But now what should I do? What happened to these guys? Should I update them? Okay. Well, any preference on which one I should update? Well, what should f of n minus 1 be after this? No, it should be what f of n is now. Yeah, it should be what f of n is now. So I'm doing it in reverse order. Either way is fine. So I'm going to add them first and then update later. You could update first or and then add. Either way is fine. So I need to update things. But which one should I update first? F of n minus 2, right? It should be which one? F of n minus 1. But if I do that, then I will throw away the sum that I will have need to put in f of n minus 1. Or did I? No, where's the story? So, update f of n minus 2 with, I guess, to be f of n minus 1, then update f of n minus 1 to be f of n. So that gives us the updates that we actually need. And then we keep going until it has either the exact same length or less length than f of n. So what should I do after my loop is done? Check the repo. Yep. So check if input length equals f of n length. If so, accept. Otherwise, we're good. Sweet. So, we can make a Turing machine to check whether an input is a Fibonacci number or not. Question, is this language decidable? Well, it seems like it is, but let's just be sure. So, have four tapes. Well, the tapes are initially blank. Okay, so that's no problem at all. We put a single one on these at the start. I didn't save my high-level description because that would come out in the low-level description. So we didn't have to necessarily think of that. Let's see. Ignore the loop for a second. Look at the inner part of the loop. Does adding f of n minus 1 and f minus 2 onto f of n, does that take a finite amount of time? Yeah. It's just concatenation, which we know how to do easily. Update, does that work in finite time? In finite time, yes. We know how to do that. It's just scanning across the tapes. No problem. So that's fine. But does the loop terminate? Or require to terminate? Yeah, because the sequence always increases. So we will always hit the length of the input in some amount of time, right? It can't ever be forever. And then checking it again obviously takes time. Cool. So this language is decidable. Very cool. Any questions about that? And you could, if you say, well, four tapes is too much, I need, like, say, three tapes, then you could put a number sign here with the result, f of n here. And then we can do that zigzagging thing here. But either method is perfectly okay. But since we showed equivalence with any number of tapes that you want, then it doesn't matter. So let's do the next one. I have to admit, it's kind of relaxing in the sense that we don't have to worry once we do high-level descriptions about what the actual machine does. We can just write the algorithm based off what we already know. It's pretty nice, I have to admit. So this one is not a language anymore. It is a computational problem. So our input, so this is number three, input is just a bunch of ones in the tape, and we want to output ones in the P, where P is the smallest prime at least n. And then halt and accept, let's say. So this is not a language now. It's actually a computational problem. Okay? Why would I be interested in this? In doing a computational problem, let's say. How could this aid me? What's that? Well, if I want to halt with the result that I want on the tape, how could that help me? Well, maybe what we can do is we can think of the accept state of this machine as the start state in another machine. So maybe what we can do is we can hook this machine into a larger machine, and then the output of this will be the start of some other part of the machine where it checks something about this prime number. So you can think of little computational problems like this in terms of aiding other problems. So like here, you could, for instance, have a machine similar to this one, where you have a bunch of zeros on the tape and you output the Fibonacci number that's right after that number. Okay. So if I'm given, let's say, 0 to the 14, like here, I want to output 0 to the 24, right? So maybe we can use that to check something here, or some other problem. So it just makes our lives easier by working with other problems. Fine. So, how am I going to use this to help? If I have one to be hand on the table, and I want to find the next prime right after n. So what would an idea be to do that? What would be a pseudocode type algorithm? So here's the idea. While true, so even more Pythonic, I guess, check if n is prime, and then if so, what should I immediately do? Output it and stop the loop. If not, what should I do? Add one, right? N plus one. Okay. Will this loop terminate? What's that? Yeah, and how do I know? Yeah, it's incrementing, but how do I know it just doesn't keep incrementing forever? There are infinitely many prime numbers. So there has to be a prime larger than n. Fine. Okay, well, how am I, so I know how to do this part, and I know how to do this part pretty easily, right? Output on tape, just literally put it on the tape, and add one to it, that's just, in this case, add one on the end to it. So that's no problem at all. How do I do this? And the infinite, the while true loop, I can easily. But checking if a number is prime.
Reiterate from 1 to the range of n to see if the number divides into it.
Right, okay. So, yeah, okay. So here's the idea. So for I equals 2 to n, I don't need to do 1 here. And actually, I shouldn't do 1 here because 1 divides every single number. And I actually shouldn't do n either. I should do n minus 1. So if n mod I equals 0, return, so you can see what I've been coding over the weekend, right? And then if every single divisor returns false, then we should return true. Okay, well, let's see. I know how to do this guy, iterating from 2 to n minus 1. So, should I do this on one tape or two? I mean, I could do it on one, but would two make it easier? Yeah, how would the second tape aid me here? Maybe I can store this I on the second tape. Okay, so here's the idea. Store I on second tape. And then going from 2 to n minus 1, that's no problem. And I know how to start from 2 and to add 1 every single time. To get to n minus 1, could I check that? That I has length n minus 1? I should keep going if it's n minus 1. But should I go through this loop if I is equal to n? No. Could I check equality of strings? Yeah, I can certainly do that. So if they're ever equal, so if length, I'll be more informal. It's equal to length of n, stop. But otherwise, what should I do to do remainder? Could I do remainder? Yeah, let's see. So here's the graphical idea. So I have this itty bitty I right there, and a whole bunch of ones for N right there. Okay? Well, how can I check whether this number divides that number in unary? So, what do? I just cross off the length of this guy every single time. If I, let's just see for this case, I think it actually does, I'll make it so that it doesn't. So, I cross a 4 in a single iteration, then I cross a 4 more in a single iteration, then I cross off 1, but then I can't cross off anymore. So, does that number divide? No. So, if it's a clean power, if it divides evenly, then the first character I should be looking at is a blank symbol. So therefore, I know how to do mod. And so, I know how to do this, I know how to do this, 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 and this. So therefore, I know how to do that. Yeah?
Just to make it true, it says when you put one in, it happens when D repeats the next time after it. So we need to decrement N before we end the loop.
Yes. So this, no, I do it right here.
Yeah, but you check if it's prime immediately entering the loop, and then you stop if it is prime.
Yeah, so if N happens to be a prime, I should immediately stop because it's the...
I
see what you mean.
The next one.
Okay, yeah, I guess I'm going to insert an N++ in the beginning. Yeah, because you are correct in saying that it should be the... It depends on your... English is terrible. it depends on your interpretation of what next after means, but what I meant to mean is the smallest prime at least n, but in your case, you are correct in saying that it could be at least n plus 1 and then therefore this one. Because it could be the case that n itself is prime, and then you want the next prime. So, and if n itself is not prime, then adding 1 to it will, like, not find the next prime anyway. So you are correct. Okay. Cool. So let's see. Is this problem, so we can't really say that this is a decidable problem, right? Because it's not a language. But does it always halt? Well, we know there's always a prime at least n, so that's no problem. So this loop must only run a finite number of times. Because I know that there is a prime at least n. Well, the only problem might be is if checking if n is prime, but we know this loop only runs a finite number of times based on n, and then this step takes only a finite amount of time as we outlined there, and then therefore this problem always holds. Well, the Turing machine for this always holds. Okay? So, how do I turn this into a language and then say, yeah, that's decided? I need to turn it into a problem where I say yes or no on a certain string. So here's the idea. Let L be 1 to the N, pound sign, 1 to the P, where P is the next prime after N. Well, how can I claim that this language is decidable? So what do? What I need to do is I want to keep this prime right here. Either move it onto another tape or keep it right here on the first tape. That's fine. Well, let's see. What if I just run the exact same algorithm that I did? Well, the problem might be I'm going to add an additional 1 right here, and then I would have to shift everything to the right. So I could put it on a second tape to avoid that problem, or I could do that and bear the problems there. Then, once I do this, I'm going to have 1 to the p on or some prime on the tape right here. Then what do I do for both halves? Check if they're equal. Okay? So, by phrasing it like this, I can convert it into a problem that actually I can say is a decidable problem. Is a decidable language. So by this reasoning up here, since the original prompt always halted, therefore checking whether an input of this type is of that type must always halt with this Turing machine idea, and then therefore the language is assignable. Okay? Any questions about that? All right, I'll see you next week.